At Mountain Dew, we'd like to remind you that the world as we know it would not exist without the number zero. Which is why, at Mountain Dew, we'd like to recognize the number zero for making Mountain Dew Zero Sugar possible. Even with no sugar, it packs all of the bold citrus kick Dew Nation knows and loves. It's so good, you have no reason not to try it. As in zero. Get it? Crack open an ice-cold Mountain Dew Zero Sugar. It's zero sugar. All Dew.
Don't put off getting your oil changed, Memphis, the Grizzlies' official partner. Take 5 oil changes faster than you think. There's no appointment needed. There isn't even a waiting room. Yep, you heard that correctly. Take 5 oil changes so fast you don't even have to get out of your car. You can take advantage of Take 5's fast, friendly, and simple service at any of their locations across the Memphis area. And remember, at Take 5, you stay in your car because they're faster than you think. That means you won't even have time to show off your perfect jump shot or your killer crossover. Take 5, the stay in your car 10-minute oil change.
Memphis fans can now enhance each moment of their day with the refreshingly luxurious taste of Cintron sparkling flavored energy beverages, served exclusively at FedEx Forum. Cintron World is a lifestyle beverage brand inspiring everyone to create their lives with intention, energy, and style. As the official partner of the Grizzlies, Cintron is offering a 10% discount on your next online order when you use promo code Grizzlies10 at CintronWorld.com and follow the lifestyle on social at Cintron World. Drink it. Live it.
Topic number one, I think, was not so creative.
Okay.
And it is the new color of this eggplant retro foam.
Okay.
I was going to bring this, the actual original in, and I forgot.
Well, we have a picture of the original, too. If we could go to that second. Okay. Okay. The Sneak Fest Show, live Tuesdays at 2 p.m. on YouTube at Grind City Media and the official Grind City Media app.
Rob, we got a banger that you guys need to play. So I'm going to send this to you right here, and you just play it for the people. We are SEC.
It just means more.
We got all the Southeast with me.
Oh, yes, we do.
Tune in to the Jessica Benson Show with CJ Hurt live every weekday at 8 a.m. on YouTube at Grind City Media and the official Grind City Media app.
Let's talk about some guys that you would love to see in different situations.
LaMelo Ball.
Ooh, spicy. Boban. He plays on Houston right now, and I think he's too lovable to just sit there and lose all the time. I love him, and I would like him to be on a contending team so he can smile more because the world needs more Boban smiles.
He's in every commercial.
IMHO with Lang Whitaker and me, Kelsey Wright Johnson, on YouTube at Grind City Media and the official Grind City Media app.
We got a special guest, Kelvin Gates.
I treat HBCU Huddle like my ESPN HBCU Huddle. You know, and I'm getting mad, I'm throwing stuff, I'm driving fast because Mike said something bad about Jackson State. He predicted, CJ might have predicted that we might lose again.
Get all of your HBCU sports and culture news by tuning in to HBCU Huddle with CJ Hurt and Mike Wallace. New episodes drop every Thursday on GrindCityMedia.com, YouTube, and Spotify.
The Braves have been the hottest team in baseball. Their June was just phenomenal. And you look at the numbers, the Braves are the betting favorite to win the World Series.
The Braves are like clearly been one of the best teams in the league, if not the best team in baseball all season. And like, I don't know how to pick against him. And they're going to get better.
The Odds Couple with Rob Fisher, Lang Whitaker, John Roser, and CJ Hurt live Thursdays at 2 p.m. on YouTube at Grind City Media and the official Grind City Media app.
Sonic has something delicious for you.
Hey, announcer guy, that's your cue.
Try the $2.99 Strawberry Shortcake Snowball Slush Float from Sonic. An icy slush with real strawberries topped with a snowball of ice cream and crunchy sugar crystals. Your official sweet escape this summer.
Well, I don't know about you, but I'm definitely craving that previously mentioned thing.
$2.99 Strawberry Shortcake Snowball Slush Float.
Sonic.
Limited time only. Participating Sonic drive-ins. Price applies to medium size only. Tax not included. Select markets now feature soft serve.
Get your Mardi Gras beads ready. Fat Tuesday Memphis is now open. The world's most famous daiquiri bar is opening on Main Street and will be the official pregame party destination for your Memphis Grizzlies. Try the famous Fat Tuesday 190 Octane, Cat 5 Hurricane, or Miami Vice, or create your own signature drink with 12 delicious flavors to choose from. Grab your friends and book your next birthday party or girls' night out at the new Fat Tuesday Memphis, located at 8 South Main Street, where we get the party started.
Live from downtown Memphis, this is the Chris Vernon Show, presented by Caesars Sportsbook on YouTube at Grind City Media and the official Grind City Media app. Now, here's your host, Chris Vernon.
GrindCityMedia.com. Chris Vernon Show. Welcome. It's a Thursday, August 10th, 2023 edition of the show. Today on the show, FedEx St. Jude Golf Tournament has begun as guys are playing out at Southwind. We have been there for the first part of the week. We are in studio today for our last show of the week. We'll get to what all is going on at the golf tournament. A guy that is not at the golf tournament is back in the news. In addition to that, we've got some things that we've watched. We're going to play Fill in the Blank Sucker. It is a big day in Memphis. It's one of the biggest sporting events that we have in town. Is now underway after a delay. Let's do it. Turn it up! Everybody's having a good day. All right. We got a lot of stuff to get to. It has been a busy week thus far as we have been out at the golf tournament. I'll tell you all about what took place yesterday. And then woke up this morning and it was terrible outside. It was thundering. It was pouring rain. And they had announced that things were going to be pushed back, but it appears as if we're done with rain, and they were able to start the tournament today at 10:15. Guys started teeing off this morning, and so now we've got a ton of groups that are out on the course, and it appears that everything's going to be okay. Got started a little bit late. Yesterday got completely screwed up, and I'll tell you all about that. Before I get to anything, I welcome John Roser to the show. John Roser, a.k.a. the Cologne Ranger, the Body Free Bandit, Senior Set, a.k.a. Johnny Back Bulls out of America, a.k.a. the Grim Roser, Johnny Spirit, Johnny Netcarb, a.k.a. Yogi Roser.
Might as well call us Aerosmith, because we're back in the saddle.
Kelsey Wright Johnson's here. She is Brampton's finest. She is the Nordstrom Rack track queen. She is Puerto Rico's favorite reporter, the ketchup chip connoisseur. Oh, tough go in Germany for your guy yesterday.
Yeah. If we're being honest, it was a tough go for my entire country in Germany yesterday.
They did not do well. Did not do well. Cannot embarrass your country like that on the national stage.
That was really bad.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Worse, that or the women's soccer team in America?
More
embarrassing.
What did they do?
No, they lost.
They lost.
Oh.
Like,
Probably more embarrassing.
Wow.
Nikhil was the leading scorer at half with 9 points.
It's
no gay.
Tough.
Two thumbs down.
It's tough.
Shout out Canada. Let's talk about golf.
Devin Walker will be with us in a little bit because he went out to Spring Creek Ranch, a local golf course, because there is a celebrity pro-am benefiting the St. Jude Children's Hospital this morning and taking part in said pro-am. Is the Grizzlies' Luke Kennard, who I am told is an awesome golfer. I have not seen Luke Kennard play golf.
I saw one swing this morning.
And you did?
Like, not that I know a lot about
golf. And it looked like he's a golfer?
Looked smooth.
Yeah, somebody told me that he's a golfer. Luke Kennard's there. O.J. Anderson, the former running back, he's there. Our own Pete Prenica and Brevin Knight are both playing in it. Santonio Holmes is a big golfer.
I love Santonio Holmes being in there.
You know who else is?
Santonio Holmes, one of the biggest.
So a lot of the receivers. Golden Tate, also a big one. But Sterling Sharp is there. John Barry is there. Ron Harper. The one I would be most excited to see of anybody that is playing in this thing today is Spud Webb.
Yeah, Spud Webb's cool.
I mean, that would be awesome.
Shout out Spud Webb. Ron Harper for me.
Spud Webb would be. Alonzo Mourning as well.
Alonzo's cool.
Because I just want to see him swing a golf club.
Yeah.
He's a giant. My man Bobby Bones, country music DJ out of Nashville. He's here.
No idea who that is.
Come on. DJ from Nashville? Roser.
Brad Penny, former pitcher.
Did he win World Series MVP?
No,
that was Beckett. I think that was Beckett.
Isaac Bruce.
We know Isaac Bruce,
Memphis great, and now Pro Football Hall of Famer.
They got a good list.
Yeah,
I didn't know Santonio Holmes was a golfer. Oh, Kelsey, you should know this about Santonio Holmes, but you don't, even though you are a Steelers fan. Uh-huh. Santonio Holmes, one of the most famous catches in Super Bowl history.
He did
won the Steelers their 6th Super Bowl championship. It's an amazing catch. Google it.
Santonio Holmes is out there. So, they've got a big group. So, anyways, we were out at the golf tournament yesterday, and in the morning we got set up. And so then about Tommy Fleetwood, it said he was going to be able to do this bit with me. And the day gets, like, screwed up very early.
Oh, no.
Because the pro-am is, like, going on. Some of the groups like teed off at like 7 o'clock in the morning, and then other groups were going to be playing later in the day. And I'm walking around outside, and these guys are, you know, a lot of the groups are still in their pro-am. And then guys are like, anybody that gets done with the pro-am is now going straight to the driving range, because the word's getting around, like, you're looking up at the sky and it's kind of cloudy. And me and Devin are walking by, and I told Devin, I said, bro, when this thing opens up, this thing is going to open up. As soon as this sky decides that it's going to start doing its rain thing, it is going to dump out here. Mm-hmm. Because you could just tell it was looking like super ominous. And so
it was dark.
Yes.
Yes.
And guys were going over and guys were going over to the range like immediately. After they were doing their pro-am, because they're like, if I don't get my practice session in right now, we're done for the rest of the day. Mm-hmm. So we got to get this in right now. So we kind of got pushed back a little bit. And so now I'm like, all right, Tommy's going to go do his thing. Some of these other guys are going to do theirs. And then there's a whole other group that's going to be doing their pro-ams a little bit later. But about, I think, 7 holes in to the first wave of the pro-am guys, it starts dumping. So they're all having to, like, run in. Everybody's, like, running in, right? And so now at that point, it's the forecast is terrible. Bunch of guys are, like, just trying to find, how do we get to our cars? How do we get back to, you know, wherever we're staying at the course or off course? And so everybody's, like, scrambling around. Everybody's just trying to get undercover. It's all pouring and whatever. And I'm like, oh, no. I was like, I'm dead on this, right? Because now we're not going to be able to track every, you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. Once something like that hits, you're not going to be able to track the guys down. anymore. And I don't blame them, right? Because it's like, all right, everybody's just trying to figure out what to do. Mm-hmm. And they're trying to get to, you know, somebody's calling them and figuring out, like, how are we, you know, in some cases, their wives or girlfriends are out there, their families, maybe their kids are out there, their agents out there, maybe a handler is out there. And so everybody's just trying to figure out how they're getting where. And I'm like, oh my God, like all these interviews that I've got set up are going to get screwed up. Luckily, very luckily, my buddies over at Ping had given Thigala a heads up. And so when Thigala made his way to the clubhouse, one of the people ran into him and was like, hey, this is where Chris is set up. And so Sahith came in there, and it was hilarious because the only people I saw, like I saw Thigala, Tatum was like walking around everywhere because he had just played in the Pro-Am.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And his deal was he played the first seven holes before they started getting dumped on with Rom, and then Thigala was going to be on the last nine holes. For anybody that saw that interview, he kind of mentions that. But Sahith Thigala was the absolute sweetest guy ever. He was
not
like
fanboying over Jason Tatum.
Yeah,
that was so
he was
funny.
So great because he was so like, and it's funny. Like we talked about it. We talked about it in the interview, but before we ever even like recorded and we were hooking up the microphones and everything, the first thing he said to me was like, "Dude, I just choked so hard." And I was like, what? And he's like, I was so excited to meet Jason Tatum. I just wanted to talk about basketball. And then I was like,
it's so funny.
And he's like, and I was so excited to get to play with him later today. And that's not going to happen. And so I'm hoping they got to yesterday afternoon, because I guess the second wave did go off at 2 o'clock yesterday. I think they were able to get some of the second wave of the Pro-Am in yesterday afternoon. But the other thing was,
That's really cool. Like getting someone like Jason Tatum to play. That's
so cool.
Massive name.
That's a big name.
Yes.
So, you just stayed at Marcus Smart's house?
No. You know what? Somebody told me yesterday, there's two different connections to Memphis.
Yeah, he played for the War Eagles AAU growing up.
He did.
Okay.
Somebody yesterday told me his stepdad's from here.
Oh, okay.
That's interesting.
So, like, there's like a, he comes here every summer.
He does, because he's gone over to the University of Memphis.
Yeah.
With, like, Penny and done stuff over there.
He's here every summer.
Well, let's look it up.
For some reason. So, he obviously has connections here. Oh, and it's obviously very close to St. Louis. I mean, it's only four and a half hours away.
So, hey, Jason, you want to play in Memphis?
Yeah, right? So, anyways, Tatum's out there and a bunch of those guys. And then the other thing that was so cool was to see the St. Jude kids back out there again. You know, the ones that they posted the video yesterday, the thing I did with Spieth and Rom. And those kids that were out there, Olivia and Calvin. Calvin was out there yesterday, and I would alert everybody to go check out the Twitter feed of the FedEx St. Jude Championship. They put up this video of Max with Calvin, who is the Max Homa with Calvin, who is the kid that was out there with us the other night. And Calvin might have the absolute greatest personality of a 16-year-old you would ever want to be around. Aww. In your life. Calvin's been to hell and back with this stuff. He had a brain tumor, and everything's okay now. I think he got it when he was like 10 or 11. Everything's fine with it, but he's like, but you really got to keep an eye on it. He has had 8 surgeries.
Wow.
8. And he is the most outgoing, funny kid you can imagine. And one of the things he says is, you know, after the 8 surgeries and the brain tumor, he's like, I was a really quiet kid. And he's like, and one of the lessons I learned from it is that you got to live life to the fullest. So he's like, and I've got to talk to people, and I've got to become more outgoing. And so he is so damn funny. He is the one that the other night came up to me and they introduced him. They were like, hey, here's one of the St. Jude patients. Here's Calvin, whatever. And he comes up and he says, you are so lucky. You're so lucky. And I was like, man, I know, brother. And he's like, where I'm from, gas is like over $6. Oh my God. And gas is $3 or something here. And I was like, oh.
You're like, oh, wait, yeah. That's not what you meant.
I was like, oh, yeah. Wow. So
you were ready to get deep with him.
Was telling Homa, I saw the video last night, and I texted the homie Max Homa, and I told him how much I love the video of Calvin. So Calvin has two phrases, and he put them on the shoes. You know, he was one of the ones that got to design the shoes that some of the players would wear. So you got it. The video's great. The shoe that he had originally designed, they met for the first time yesterday in person. They had always Zoom called. And they're so excited when they get to meet each other because
like
he had
the
designed
two kids?
The kid Calvin and Max Homa.
Okay.
Max Homa's the pro. Yeah, yeah. And so they had the shoe, and on one side it says keep that smile you've got or something like that. Something about keep it smiling. You see that smile, keep that smile. Something like that. And then the other one is motivation is key. And then on the other shoe he had like French fries and chicken nuggets, like things that he likes.
Yeah.
Whatever. And so anyways, I saw the video and I was telling Max about what happened the other night. And I was like, this dude, you want to talk about throwing me for a loop? He's like, no, man, gas is like over $6 where I'm from.
That's
and I, we
so
passed
funny,
a gas station, it's like $3. And he said, hold on, I got to tell you what he said to Homa. You can watch the video. This did not make the video, but he said, Calvin's truly the GOAT. I've never met anyone like him. He said, we asked him if he wanted to pick up the bag for the cameras, and he said, no, I'm not getting paid. I'm good.
Wait, he sounds so cute.
Oh, he's the best.
That's awesome.
Oh, he's the best.
He
Calvin.
Sounds so
and
cute.
And so he's one of the kids, and then Olivia was the other one. And watching Max interact with them and then watching both Rahm and Spieth the other night, I kind of, you know, I couldn't, you know, there's only so much you could fit into the amount of characters, but, and I mentioned this briefly the other day, I was blown away by both of them. I've done a lot of events with athletes over the years, and those guys, like, gave 100% maximum effort into making that special, right? For the kids, interacting with the kids. You like the participation in like so what they did, and you can't see this on the video, so they had a chipping contest where we had like chipping targets put up, then they played FedEx, which was their version of horse, and so they did basically like trick shots, and then at the end them and the kids, there's about like 70 boxes all stacked up. And they had to go and they had to shake through the boxes until they found the golf ball. Then they had to sprint, make a chip, and then make a long putt. And it's all using these like little, you know, the kid putters, right? These big like toy looking putters. And here I am, I'm standing there watching it, and they want to win. Like, Jordan Spieth and John Rahm are sprinting to get to this thing and trying to, like, mess each other up and whatever else. And, like, the kids are keeping score and are part of the team the whole time. Oh, it's unbelievable. Now, the funniest ever, Olivia, who's sweet as could be. Olivia was Spieth's partner. And, again, you won't see this on the video, but it's hilarious. The first competition we do, Rahm... We have 10 targets set up. The dude hits 9 of them. Right? Spieth then
the best golfer in the world.
Spieth follows it up, hits like 7 of the 10. We look over, Olivia has got both hands, arms on the table with her head down, and she's starting to cry.
No!
And I'm like, look what you've done, John Rahm.
No.
We had to get her back in the fold. We were like, Olivia, there's two more competitions.
She was the younger one.
She was, I think Olivia is 9.
Okay.
I think.
I could see my little brother like, crying over
oh,
there.
Oh, but they were all in on it. They were unbelievable with the kids.
Also, you should try and get that in the story because that's funny.
It was so encouraging to see them and to see how much St. Jude and getting to interact with these kids meant to them.
Yeah.
Because I think that You know, anytime that you're doing something like that, you have the opportunity to either go all in with it and really, you know,
make it special.
And man, they did. And they were so cool. And I will tell you, this is something that, like, I'll tell you on the show because it happened yesterday. So when I went out there, Jenna, who works with the show, came out there with me, and she was like taking pictures and whatever, right? And as we were going through everything, and yesterday, Jenna is out there at the course with us, and she is walking by, like, kind of like where they practice, and Jordan Spieth yells at her like, "Hey, oh, it's great to see you again." What? Jenna doesn't know anybody. You know what I'm saying? But I mean, she knows who Jordan Spieth is because she was at the event the other night. Yeah. But she's not a big golf fan.
Yeah.
And whatever. But like, came out of his way, and like, and I'm like, you know what, man? Like, everybody I've told that's like out there, like either the guys with Ping that I was with yesterday, or the Gala, or other golfers, whatever. I tell you this. Unbelievable reviews for Spieth. Every single person I say, like, wow, I mean, I was just so blown away at how awesome he was because I've been a fan for so long. They're like, he is the best.
Yeah.
And then sure enough, Jenna's like, "Do you know who just stopped me out there?" And I was like, "Who?" She's like, "Jordan Spieth." I'm like, "What?" She's like, I didn't even really talk to him, but he recognized me from the event yesterday. And I was like, you know, man, like those guys. Some of those guys, like, you meet guys like this, right, that are incredibly charming and nice guys, right?
Yeah.
And so he had just recognized her from being at the event. That's and, so cute. And so stopped her along the way. And so, look, I promise you this, she'll be a Jordan Spieth fan
she'll
forever.
Be a Jordan Spieth. So I right? talked to Tuesday while y'all were still doing the show. I stepped outside and I ran into Giannotto, and that's when, like, walking right past me, Hideki Matsuyama came by me, Colin Morikawa came by me, which I'm still blown away every time I see Morikawa, how little he is.
Yes.
And then Rom comes yep. out. Bro, Rom, he was like, "Hey, what's up, guys?" And I was like, "Yo, what's up, John?" And he stopped. Because he was like, "Wait, did they know me? What?" He stopped and talked to, like, me and Giannotto for like 3 minutes.
Wow.
Just talked to us. He's wearing Kobe's.
Hey!
He's a big basketball fan.
He is
a
big basketball fan.
Rom is.
Because I told you the other day when I was talking to them before we started the event, we were talking about basketball. And it's so funny to hear golfers. Like, at one point we're talking and they're like, "Can you believe Jaylen Brown got $300 million? You know what I mean? And it's like... You know what I mean? These guys are like real sports fans.
It's like, well, you couldn't, you know, too, if you would have gone to live.
Hey, they were like, one of the things they both said to me, they're like, "Man, Marcus Smart helps you win games."
Yeah.
He wins you games.
Wins
like, they're
games.
Like, they're sports fans, right?
Yes.
And that was the other thing, like, with all of them, like, a lot of those guys are, Tagala was the same way yesterday. They're like all huge sports fans. Like they watch everything.
Yeah.
Right? And I do think it's a little bit different than maybe in the past. It was fun. It was fun being out there. It was fun being around everything that was going on. And then, unfortunately, yesterday, it was terrible outside.
Bro, it was
really terrible.
Like Kelsey said, it was like
no, dark.
I opened my balcony door and the wind, like, shot it open. And I looked out, I'm like, "Bro, it looks like it's like 9 o'clock at night outside."
I don't have a door on my bedroom because it's like a loft style thing.
Yeah.
And I woke up at whatever, like 9 a.m. and it was like, I thought it was still middle of the night.
Right.
Like, it was
dark.
Yeah.
No, I'm the same way. I don't have a door in my bedroom. So mm-hmm. usually I wake up in the morning when the light's out.
Yeah.
And I can see the light kind of creeping
That's
through.
That's what wakes me up usually.
Yeah, it was not that way at all.
So
it's brutal.
It's going on right now. You got a bunch of guys that are already at 3 under. Like, you're going to see some low scores today because the hard part about this course is that it's like narrow fairways, and they can, especially when it's hot outside, they can roll off into the side, like the first or second cut, and then that rough is like impossible to hit out of. It's not going to do that because it's wet, so your ball's going to plug in many cases or just stop. And then these greens are going to be so soft. And as I've told you, this is not a hard putting course. And so I think you're going to see some really low numbers be put up today by a lot of these golfers, especially just given the conditions. And the whole place is just going to be super soft all day because it's just they said it's taken over 2.5 inches of rain.
So you said that we were talking before we went on the other to Scottie Scheffler, because he's like – he's number one in driving. He's number one from the fairway. He's number five around the green, but he's 135th in putting. And you said he has a new putter for this week. So does Rory.
Yep.
So Rory's trying a new putter,
well,
too.
Well, he hadn't made any putts in any of these majors.
Yeah, well.
I don't think I've seen
him. Ever.
Ever.
Like in 10
he
years.
He used to.
In 10 years, he hasn't.
Yeah, I know. And I'll tell you this. He had this TaylorMade Hydro, and I saw him have it, and I've got that same putter, and so I put it in my bag last weekend. I didn't make nothing with it either. It's the putter! It's the putter!
It has to be.
The putter stinks! I had to go back to my ping answer. I couldn't make anything with it either, Rory.
Oh, my God.
So funny. You know, so I was talking about that Pro-Am. They've changed it up to where now, if you're in that Pro-Am, like you play 9 holes with one pro and 9 holes with another. So that's how the Tatum thing was split up yesterday.
Yeah.
It used to be you'd play like all 18 with one guy. And that's how we met Harold Varner III years ago when we played in it with him. But now it's not as bad for these. Like, you know what I mean? Like 9 holes is enough. And so then they switch over. But years ago, it made me think about a guy that's now in the news constantly, Greg Norman, because of the Live thing.
Yeah.
That he was – there was a guy – that was with our group that his buddy got paired up with Norman years ago at this for the Pro-Am. And he's like, he did not like talk to like anybody in the group, like virtually the whole time. And he's like, and at one point my buddy's walking up the fairway and he's like, hey, Greg, he's like, you know, kind of been playing golf. Like, you've been watching, like, you've been seeing us all day. And he's like, I was just wondering, like, do you have any tips for us? Oh. And Greg Norman goes, loft, mate. And he's like, what? He's like, loft, mate. And he's like, what? So then they get up to the green. He's like, Greg, what were you talking about with, like, loft? And he goes, lack of talent.
Oh, my God.
He's like, Greg Norman's a dick.
Oh, that is well known about Greg Norman, that there's nobody who has ever come across Greg Norman that likes him.
Telling a guy lack of effing talent
who you've never met in your life.
Making your own abbreviation for that and just saying it is
loft,
wild.
Loft, mate.
He's like, what is he talking about?
You're going to use that this year. I can already tell.
Loft.
I can already tell that's going to be added to the
loft, mate. So anyway, and the other one, I had another buddy that was paired up with Phil Mickelson. And given today's huge story, this is very appropriate. So Mickelson, even in like the Pro-Ams, you get to the first tee box and he's like, so what are we playing for?
Yeah.
Like, he'll gamble with your ass if you're a nobody.
Yes.
Right? And then you see today. So the Fireside Collective, I'm sorry, Fire Pit Collective, which is Alan Shipnick's website. So I'll give you, this will be good so I could explain to Kelsey. So the most famous sports gambler in the history of the world is this guy named Billy Walters. Like famously put $3.5 million on the Super Bowl 1 year and won the bet.
God.
Billy Walters he was the most successful sports bettor of all time. And he had an entire syndicate. And so he basically, if you're Billy Walters, books would then try to find out what picks were coming from Billy Walters, but you would have to have a syndicate. So, like, let's say I'm out in Vegas, right, as Billy was, and I've got now I work with a group and we have picks and we win all the time. They're gonna limit me immediately if I'm Billy Walters, right? They're gonna limit my bets. They're gonna say you can only bet whatever 5,000 on a game. You can't bet like the limits that other people can bet on these games. And so what you do is then you create this syndicate. So now I hire you, and you're going in there, and you're going to three different books.
But I'm and just you're, saying what your you're
yes, yes, yes. And now you're getting a cut of it by going and placing the bets. But that's the only way you're ever going to get any bets down for the amount of money that they want to get down is because they've got to create these groups, right? And this is how it works all through Vegas for many, many years. Because otherwise, you walk in and A, they're going to limit you. B, they're going to move the lines like significantly. So they're trying to get as much money down, and they're trying to do it all over the country, right? I mean, this guy's got more money than God, right? Like he was that good.
Sounds like it.
He got busted for insider trading, so they said. He ended up going to prison for insider trading. He was thick as thieves, big buddies with Phil Mickelson.
Okay.
Phil Mickelson was involved with Billy Walters, everybody knew, and Phil Mickelson was a big gambler, and Phil Mickelson didn't help him out when it came to the trial. And he said a lot of people said, so anyways, Billy's been in prison. Billy's been out of prison now since last year. And Billy's got a book coming out. And
did Billy write it in prison?
He wrote it post. I mean, he's been out for a year. And so now he's got this book that is going to be dropping next month.
Okay.
And it's called Gambler, Secrets from a Life at Risk. And it's about his life. And everybody wanted to know, what's this dude going to say about Mickelson? Because the big story was Mickelson is involved in all this, but somehow he's not getting charged with anything. He's skating, and Billy Walters is going to prison. Like, what the hell? So he writes in this book, and Alan, they gave Alan Shipnick an excerpt from the book that has come out, and he talks about how they became friends. He talks about how Phil was a big gambler. They had played golf together, and Phil wants to be a partner with him. And Billy says, okay, you can be a partner with me because Phil can get big limits at these offshore books that they can. Like now, Phil Mickelson can go put down big bets at his books because he's Phil Mickelson and they know he's good for the money. And those are numbers that Billy Walters just cannot get. So take it into consideration. He had two bookmakers, okay, Phil Mickelson. He could bet $20,000 a game on college football and $50,000 on NFL football, okay?
Okay.
Per game.
20-50.
Yes.
I'm locked in.
So even after the 50-50 split, Phil had a limit of $400,000 on college at offshore books and another $400,000 on NFL. So that enabled Billy Walters to now double his limits, right? He also had a $100,000 limit on college over-under bets that he could bet, right? So Phil's limits were huge.
Yeah.
Billy Walters could never bet that much on games. So the deal is, I'll put up half the money, you put up half the money, we're going to bet at your place. He could use Phil Mickelson for this. So now they're partners, right? Well, after a little while, Billy is like, I've got to bet kind of at the same times, kind of roughly the same stuff that Phil Mickelson does. You know, that's the kind of bets we have to be placing, or else somebody's going to be like, what the hell is going on here, right? And so he does. And this lasts for a good little while.
Wait, what do you mean he has to do?
I'm saying, like, if I start, like, if these are the kind of things that I bet on all the time,
and I just stop,
and then all of a sudden I start betting on other stuff, or at other times, or not in the same way that I typically bet. Like, they're gonna know, like, this is the way this guy bets, right? And so Billy's like figuring out, like, okay, we've got to do it so that they don't raise any red flags, but we could still win. Well, for the first 6 months or whatever, they're flying. I mean, they're just winning like crazy. The book finally flags Phil Mickelson, and they tell him that the betting is not nearly as erratic as it used to be. So he has to start betting by himself. They know that somebody else, because they're winning big, and he lost like hell all the time. And so then that starts with this thing, but it kind of keeps on going. And then he tells, but this is where the book gets great. He starts telling the story. He says Phil Mickelson calls him from the Ryder Cup, and he says he wants to bet four. He wants Billy to get to bet $400,000 on the United States team, of which Phil Mickelson is a part of. Billy's response was, "Have you lost your effing mind? Do you remember who Pete Rose is? The former Cincinnati manager who was banned from baseball for life for betting on his own team." And he said, you're seen as a modern-day Arnold Palmer, and you're going to risk it all for that? I want absolutely no part of it. Phil Mickelson says, all right, all right. doesn't bet on. And by the way, they ended up losing. That's called the Miracle at Medina, and that's when the Europeans ended up winning. So anyways, he goes on, and he starts talking. He says it was nothing for Phil Mickelson to bet 20 grand on a five-game NBA parlay. Or that's wager insane. $100,000 or $200,000 on a game. And he said, this is what he has in the book. From 2010 to 2014, Phil Mickelson, it says he bet $110,000, a total of 1,115 times. On 858 occasions, he bet $220,000 on a game. The sum of those almost 2,000 wagers is more than $311 million. In 2011 alone, he made 3,154 bets. I mean, I think this is like when you think you bet a lot.
3,000 bets?
Bro, that is 10 a day. Every day.
Yeah.
For a year.
Talking hundreds of thousands of dollars. Like.
So don't ever feel bad about you guys betting then. You
are on not one close day.
He also has the money to do it, Phil Mickelson.
On one day, he bet on, he had 43 bets in one day on baseball games.
Shut up.
And lost $143,000. Huh. He made a staggering 7,065 wagers on football, basketball, and baseball. And he said, based on our relationship and what I've learned since, his losses approach not $40 million that's been previously reported, but much closer to $100 million. That's what Billy Walters says. And he goes through it, all through it, and he says that he says a number of people in the media, on Twitter, and in the golf world have suggested that Phil ratted me out on insider trading charges, leaving the trial in New York. That's not what happened. What happened was much worse. I was like, oh, God. Phil Mickelson, one of the most famous people in the world and a man that I considered a friend, refused to tell the simple truth that he shared with the FBI that could have kept me out of prison. I never told him I had inside information on stocks, and he knows it. All Phil had to do was publicly say it, and he refused. The outcome cost me my freedom, tens of millions of dollars, and a heartbreak I struggle with today. While I was in prison, my daughter committed suicide.
Oh!
I still believe I could have saved her if I'd have been on the outside. While this excerpt focuses solely on our betting relationship, my book's going to explain how Phil Mickelson finagled his way out of not one, but two cases that ended in criminal convictions.
Oh my God.
As my book makes clear, Phil is not the person that he seems to be.
Oh.
Wow.
Phil and his PR staff have to be shitting themselves.
Oh
right?
My God.
Yeah.
I mean, this is headlines. People now have gotten everywhere. The excerpt. Yeah, it's everywhere.
Oh, my God.
Have you seen he wagered over $1 billion?
No, it is.
At one point, he says something about, I'm not even going to, it says something about, it's not for me to say about his personal life or whatever.
ESPN.com front page, the first big story is an NFL thing. But, like, you go to top headlines, first top headline. Book Phil bet over $1 billion. Tried Ryder Cup wager, like it's the first thing. It's the, yeah.
Act like this ain't on pre-order.
Oh my gosh!
On Amazon, brother. This book, Gambler Secrets from a Life at Risk, and this is not like some mega shady character. Everybody knew Billy Walters.
Yeah,
you know what I mean. It comes out August 22nd. So what's that? It's less than 2 weeks.
Yeah, it's the 10th right now.
Less than 2 weeks. The Michael Jordan of sports betting. He's like a living legend, right? And so he wrote an autobiography about it. But wow. people want to know about the Mickelson stuff because they were like buddies. Like they'd play golf together all the time. They're around each other. Everybody knew they were involved. And as soon as Billy got in some kind of trouble, Phil, like, bolted. He, like, just acted like he didn't, you know. And he's like, he could have kept me out of jail. And he didn't.
And he chose not to.
You don't think he hates him with the fires of seven hells?
So do you think that the stories are going to be, like, knowing how much he's...
Oh, I think the whole thing's going to be about what a dirtbag this guy is, and he is not what you think he is.
I know, but do you think that comes out of complete honest reality, or does it come out of a little bit like I was just in jail because of this guy and I hate him and I'm gonna bring him down?
I'm sure there's a little bit of both. Yeah, like there's gonna be stuff in there that is probably gonna be extreme about Phil because
dramatized a little bit.
This guy really does not like him. Like he feels, and probably rightfully so, that Phil Mickelson could have kept him out of jail, and he didn't keep him out of jail. And
yeah, like those feelings are...
Yeah, so there's going to be some more extreme stuff in there, and then Phil's going to have his side of things, and the truth is probably going to be somewhere in the middle.
But what I'm saying is this guy is not some kind of, like... Just keep in mind, this guy, on a typical, like, weekend, like Saturday, Sunday, football weekend, they would have over $10 million in bets.
That hurts my stomach. Hurts my stomach.
Just laid out across various casinos.
I mean, he would bet $10 million, and that was nothing to him.
That doesn't give you guys anxiety?
It's like, ashtray money. Like, no, it's ashtray money to him. No, he wins. That's the reason he wins. And no one knew. Like, he's very mysterious.
He said in a good year, he went between $50 and $60 million in a good year gambling.
He's very mysterious guy. People didn't really know. Everybody knew the name, Billy Walters. And people would always try to figure out what Billy Walters' picks were or whatever. You know who knew him? Allen, Boston.
Yeah.
He knew Billy because Allen was one of those guys.
Have you talked to Allen about it? About him?
I've talked to him about Billy in the past.
Yeah.
He likes Billy.
Do you think he'll get the book?
100%.
Yeah, I could see him enjoying that.
100%, right? Anyways, it's kind of crazy that all dropped today. Imagine if Mickelson was here.
Because he would be here if he was on the PGA Tour.
If he was on the PGA Tour, he would be here playing right now.
If he was in the top 70, he would be.
Right.
We don't know if he'd be in the top 70.
Maybe not, but I mean, probably.
If it was 125, he'd have a chance.
Bro, let me just say, and I look.
Because he came here all the time.
I love Memphis. I love St. Jude. I love this tournament. There were a ton of guys out there that walked by me with caddies that I have no idea.
That is the...
So the idea that Phil Mickelson could... I mean, I know Justin Thomas missed it, but like...
And Adam Scott.
Well, hold on. Just by virtue of him being second at the Masters, he'd be in the top 70.
Yeah.
He did get second at the Masters.
Yeah.
Right?
Second or third, yeah.
It was second. It was Rahm and then Mickelson.
Yeah.
So, and I think Koepka, right? I think those were the two.
Yeah, Koepka and Mickelson were T2.
Yeah.
Yeah, they were both 800.
Look at my memory. Bad bar. Shout out to me. Anyways.
Did you just call yourself an elephant?
Yes.
Okay.
They have amazing memories.
Okay, no.
Learn it. they, look, he would have been at the top 70 to be here and imagine. You want to talk about overwhelming this golf tournament? And now all the, like, a lot of these guys are, like, stressed out about if they're going to make the Ryder Cup or not. Ricky Fowler just hit that thing straight in the water on 14. Like, in the middle of the lake. Not even, like, close.
He doesn't look happy.
Oh, boy.
He's wearing sunglasses, and the sun's not out.
Future's so bright. I will say that is the one good thing about Mickelson not being here. All these, there's a bunch of these guys that are, like, nervous about making the Ryder Cup. They want to make that Ryder Cup team.
Yeah.
Bruh. If this story comes out that Phil Mickelson tried to gamble $400,000 on the Ryder Cup of which he was in.
Yeah.
Could you imagine?
I actually, I 100% do believe that.
Oh. And I will say this.
Phil's notorious for gambling on the golf course. Like,
the other thing is they're going to make a big deal out of it. There are people that are going to make a big deal out of that. Like the PGA, nobody cares about gambling. Like one of the most famous stories, and you can say, well, that's not him, that's his dad. But one of the most famous stories ever is Rory McIlroy's dad, the British Open bet. He made it... Now, you could find it if you Google it. Let me Google this so I don't want to get the story wrong. But his father, Rory McIlroy, like, had this incredible belief that his son would win the British Open one day. And so Rory McIlroy's dad waited 10 years to win a six-figure bet. Somebody offered him 500-1 odds on Rory to win the Open when he was 15 years old. And his dad and Rory's dad placed the bet. 10 years it took. He made $342,000.
That's awesome.
When Rory won the 2014 British Open. I mean, this is lauded as one of the great stories. Like in gambling history, the dad that bet on the son and then ended up winning the bet or whatever. And it's like, okay, I mean, I guess we can act like it's something terrible. There's a video, I don't know, have you seen a video going around about Phil Mickelson and DeChambeau? DeChambeau's got on his YouTube channel. Mm. They're going to play 9 holes against each other. And he's like, all right, we're going to play for a grand. Lowest hole or lowest ball, you know, if you're down,
Phil's notorious for this, playing golf. Like, every freaking round he plays, the guy he's playing against, he's like, we're gambling. They all do.
Look, betting on the Ryder Cup is a wild deal, for sure, if you're in it. But these guys all gamble all the time. One morning, I was watching, I think it was Bubba Watson, and I want to say it was Wesley Bryan, maybe? On PGA... Tour Live, the one that runs like early in the morning. So like, and this will happen like on Sunday out here. There'll be early in the morning, the guys that are in like last place will tee off. And they have absolutely no chance of winning the tournament, or they could try to improve their, it'll be a little different here because this is the playoffs. But in an average tournament, it's like, all right, now they're just going to get their rounds done, right? And they don't really have, like, all of the technology for that PGA Tour Live, and they also, like, keep boom mics on, whatever. And I remember I texted all my buddies one Sunday morning. I can't remember what tournament it was, but I was watching, and, like, Bubba Watson and, like, Wesley Bryan. This is, like, 2 years ago. And they're playing, and I just have it on just because there's nothing else on. They were so obviously... gambling with each other, like nothing else. Like it's like the tournament wasn't even going on. Yeah. Like if one of them would make the putt, the other one would be like crestfallen, and they would like, you could tell they were pressing bets, and you could tell that they were laughing at each other when they were making shots. And I'm like, this camera's literally, I was like, this would be amazing TV if everybody knew what these holes were worth. Like they're probably playing for $1,000 a hole between the two of them, because they were both out of the tournament and they're just playing, right?
Like, these guys, we got something to do.
That is golf. Everybody bets on everything.
So I guess it's okay.
No, I don't, but if you're participating in the Ryder Cup and you bet $400,000, I mean, that is wild behavior.
What if you just bet on yourself? What if you're Fred VanVleet? You just think you
can. Yeah, I don't view it the same way I do other sports. Honestly, I've always thought if you bet on yourself, it's not that bad of a deal. You know what I mean?
If you're betting on yourself to win,
yeah,
you're trying your hardest anyway. That's what I'm saying.
To me, that's not that very offensive.
What well, if, like,
if you're, betting on your, if you're betting on yourself to lose,
that's what I mean.
That is,
like,
oh, that is, yes.
Then.
That's right.
Yeah, what if, like,
but you can't delineate. You just got to say you can't do this.
What do you mean? If I bet on myself to lose and then I just throw it?
No, no, no. That's what I'm saying. You can't delineate and say, oh, yeah, you're not suspended if the bet was on yourself.
Oh, yeah.
But you are if the bet, you just can't let a bet.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean?
Like every other sport in the world.
Okay, so
well, and the other thing is, like, then you get into, you would get involved with, like, let's say you said it was okay. So, like, Patrick Mahomes, on the weekend, you could bet on a player prop, like, Patrick Mahomes over under 26.5 completions, right? So, if he has 27 completions, you win the bet. If he has less than that, you lose. Well, like, Pat Mahomes could very well say, hey, what? I was betting on myself. But it's dictating what is taking place.
He knows the game plan,
yes,
too.
He's getting, right?
Yeah.
He knows very well whether or not he's going to. Yeah. And if he's sitting on 26 completions, he's going to throw a little dinky to just get the 27, you know?
Yeah, it's, yeah. And he knows the game plan. Like, mm-hmm. he
you got to try to keep it out of it.
Like, what about, like, a Ronald Acuna? Like, his, like, if Ronald Acuna bet on his hits, like, yes, I'm betting
that's
the right. over 1.5 hits today.
Right.
He bet on himself.
Like, because I'm trying to hit
well,
it every
that's
time.
Trying to hit the ball. With, like, these guys, you got to keep – nobody's – they're going to give you a – they don't want you gambling on the stuff, but what they really don't want is you talking about gambling on the stuff. You know what I mean? I don't think there's really – it's not the same in golf as it would be with other sports either, because they're all technically independent contractors. There's no, like, players union and none of – yeah, you know.
I
so,
guess.
I'm sure it is wildly against their rules to do it. But I don't know. I think you – I mean, I wonder if you can bet on yourself to win a tournament. I don't think that that's
– it shouldn't be like
– big of a deal. No. Like if Max Homa went and put $100 on himself to win the tournament, I think you can.
But, dude, it is so hard to win golf tournaments. Like,
didn't
there's
somebody,
so many guys
I think
guys
somebody
in
else
there.
Did that. I think somebody has.
Yeah,
I think
it's not like a basketball game where there's two teams playing against each other, and it's either one or the other that's going to win. Like, it's a 50-50 chance. Like, that is not the case in golf. There's a gazillion guys in every tournament.
Yeah. All right, before we get to fill in the blank, I do want to mention, since we have last spoke, and we missed Monday with the What You Watched.
Oh, man, I have. I
oh,
told
Kelsey's.
Him. I have
such a yeah,
friggin'
she's
good
got
one.
A good
I can
one.
Keep it. But.
No, don't keep it. I watched the Johnny Football doc.
Oh, yeah, everyone's talking about that.
Did you watch it?
No, I didn't.
Did you watch it?
I have not watched it.
Everyone on my Twitter has
watched
it.
I've heard
it.
Mixed things on it.
Oh.
I've read mixed things about it.
It's 100% worth watching.
Okay.
100%. I mean, it's not, like, all-encompassing, but if you lived through it and you went to it, and, I mean, you remember so much of it, stories, like, and the details of are incredible. It, yes.
Yeah.
100%. You would love it. It's well worth watching. I don't think there's any question that any of us that watch it, there is a moment within there where you go... you see a tremendous amount of similarities between he and Ja. By the way, happy birthday to Ja.
Happy birthday, birthday to Ja.
And I'm not saying, you know, look, Johnny threw his whole career away, but he, like there was this moment where he just self-sabotaged everything. And it's not that, right? Because he got super involved with drugs and drinking. And he was never the player. Like, Ja's been all NBA and been an amazing player in the NBA. It is the cost of fame. And it is the going from a high school kid, you know, in Texas at a school, at basically a military type school, to winning the Heisman as a freshman and becoming the most famous athlete probably on the planet, winning at Alabama,
yeah,
and becoming, you know, no freshman had ever won the Heisman, and he became a super duper star, and now every single thing was at his disposal. Everything. The girls, the cars, the parties, the famous people, like everything. And he wanted to be a frat boy. He wanted to live that life, and he wanted to, you know, go have fun. But the other thing was, he was so overwhelmed by the, I can't live my life anymore.
Yeah.
You know, I am not, immediately, every single thing I do is going to show up on the internet. Every place I go is going to show up on the internet. Every picture.
Job,
I mean, and it was really, yeah. And look, and it's happened with a million actors and entertainers and musicians and comedians, everybody.
Of course.
Somebody that vaults into stardom so quickly and the handling of it. And how many times did I tell you? It is not, and this is what I remember tweeting out that day. We, and the same way, the other thing is, you see Johnny before and you see what he's like now as an adult. And then you see him change so dramatically because it's impossible not to change.
Of course.
Because of what happens to you, right? As we saw with Morant, and I never excused it, but I've said, like, you know, what this kid is dealing with, I promise you, there's moments, and you hear Johnny talk about it, and it's so much of what I've said, which is like, I promise you there are more days than not that he would trade it all to just have his life back.
Yeah.
Just to be able to go to the store. Johnny football, now his was even different. He could not go to class.
Yeah.
He couldn't go to class because he would get mobbed. Couldn't go. So he couldn't go anywhere. You know what I mean? And it's like, okay, and then he would just drink and drink and party and party and party and girls and party and girls, you know, and like all this kind of stuff. It's like any kind of escape from what had become his reality. And it's like, man, there is so much of that where it's like, you know, because it's so, when you see somebody acting like out of character, you wonder why, and you go, all right, it's not, the recklessness is not because they don't know that there's, you know, that there could be consequences. It's that you don't care about the consequences because you're so uncomfortable with what things have become, you know? And in his case, it was like, I am willingly going to sabotage this because I hate what my life has become.
Yeah.
And it's like, damn, bro. And that's the moment where you sit back and you go, you know what? It is a blessing from heaven that all of this stuff happened without some kind of, there's a bunch of terrible stuff that happened with Johnny.
Yeah.
Nothing terrible. I mean, it's obviously been blown up, but nothing terrible happened with John. Like, truly, like, you can't fix it. It's never getting better type of stuff, right? It is stuff that you can learn from and stuff that you can move on from. And that's the thing, right? It's like, look, you're still going to be famous whenever it's all over. You know, but now how do you deal with it? And he's talked about how hard it was to not know how to deal with it. And so here's hoping, you know.
When he played in the CFL, like, I remember the Argos games when I worked, we had like 5 fans a game when he came. He played for the Alouettes, maybe, whoever. Whole packed arenas.
I mean, there's no describing, like, how famous he was. Mm-hmm. He was the most famous athlete in the world for a minute, for sure. Because he was like, running around, backyard football. He was beating everybody. He was the most fun thing in the world.
Oh, it was.
Yeah. Nothing was more so fun. Awesome. Rose and I went down to Ole Miss to watch him, and it was like,
we could have picked any game to go to.
And it was
any
like, why? I mean, it was like the traveling circus or something. I mean, he was unbelievable.
I remember his first game at A&M, or at least I think it was his first SEC game. They played Florida in College Station, and I'll never forget it. Like, this is how famous, this is how, like, fun he was. Because I literally remember being like, who the hell is this quarterback at Texas A&M? This is his first game. I am on the patio at Brookhaven with Eli Savoy, who I call hustle games with, and Chris Raby. I'm sitting on the patio with them, and we're all like, who is this guy for A&M? He was so fun to watch. And then we had the luxury because Gould's was a sponsor at the time, and they invited us down to Oxford, say, pick any game you want to come to. And we were like,
you're like, duh.
A&M. We want to go to that one.
You will you will love it. Yeah. You'll love it. It's fun. It's worth watching.
No, I'm going to watch it. I'll watch it this afternoon.
There's actually two other things that I want to. So Bill Simmons.
The G League one.
The G League one came out on HBO. I have not gotten it to it yet. And that's got Scoot Henderson. And they chronicled a year in the life of the G League with four different guys. Mm-hmm. And it looks great. And then I haven't watched Hard Knocks yet. Have you watched it?
No.
I want to watch it. I've heard great reviews from the first episode.
Maybe it is. I will say the last, like, 2 to 3 years of Hard Knocks.
Try 10.
Yeah. I just get bored after, like, two episodes. I'm like, eh.
No, it's been, like, 10 years. But Rodgers playing for the Jets is something worth
it. Yeah.
Like, he is, like, very rarely do you get to see somebody like that. Where there's like a team.
Rodgers is big time. Rodgers is. Aaron Rodgers is one of the most famous athletes in the country. Like, he is.
Like, I would want to see behind the scenes with Tom Brady or Peyton Manning or Aaron Rodgers.
Kelsey knows who Aaron Rodgers is.
Yeah, he's like, he has brown hair. He's a white guy.
That's right. Yeah, but there's actually stuff I want to see. And the golf tournament, obviously, is going on as well. All right, what do you got? I want to hear it.
Holy cow.
What?
I came across the best series.
Oh.
That I think you guys should both watch.
Okay.
Usually I watch stuff and I'm like, you guys wouldn't like it, but I liked it.
Okay.
So I went to LA on the weekend. So I had 4 hours there, three and a half hours back. So I watched the entire series. It's called Hijack. It's on it's on Apple or Prime. I'm so sorry. I don't remember off the top of my head.
I don't have one
of
them.
It has Idris Elba. It is so good. Like, I was locked in. I, like, had to pee, but the episodes always have a little cliffhanger, so I, like, wasn't getting up because I had to watch the next episode.
Apple TV, yeah.
Apple TV, okay, yeah. It is, like, I couldn't recommend a series more. And then
really?
Amara. Hey,
check on your phone. Roser, if you click on your phone, I wonder how much is Apple TV? I have it. So I don't even know what I pay for the damn thing.
It's so good. Like, Apple this TV, series was so good.
I remember, you could probably watch it on a free trial.
Yeah, seven days free, then $6.99 a month.
I watched
That's
it in a day.
That's actually not bad. $6.99 a month?
That's why I have it. I bought it when my wife wanted to watch the Aniston show.
Oh, the morning show or whatever.
Apple TV or Netflix. I mean, Netflix is, like, expensive now. Netflix is, like, $20
a month. I don't pay for any of them.
She's been watching that Sex and the City reboot.
Yeah.
You know that? They updated Sex and the City.
With the same characters?
All of them, except for the one that everybody hates.
Samantha.
Kim Cattrall or whatever.
The
redhead's in it and the other one.
I had no idea that was...
Yeah, there's a whole new series.
Oh, well, obviously I'm going to watch that.
Yeah, it's updated. It's on HBO.
Oh, well, obviously I'm watching that. I loved Sex and the City.
Yeah. She might already be done with it, but that's what I know she's been watching. Because I was like, it's back?
Yeah.
It's like updated.
Interesting.
Like, it's a whole new
I'll watch that.
Set of whatever.
And Big
Hijack is great, though.
Hijack
I tell you this,
so
it's got
good.
87.
No, guys, like, it's
on
like,
Rotten Tomatoes. It says 7-episode summer thriller.
So good.
It's only 7 episodes.
Yeah, and each one is like whatever 40 minutes.
I love Idris Elba.
Oh, he's so good. He is so good in this. There's so many little like twists.
It's a thriller, huh? It says a commercial jet is hijacked from London to Dubai.
Yeah. Oh my God.
And he's
so
a passenger on it.
Just a regular.
I'm
guy.
With it.
Yeah, it's so
I'm
good.
With this. Hour-long episodes?
Yeah, I think hour 40.
7 episodes, I can do that.
Yeah, it's so, and like, they're easy to watch episodes, you know? Like, there's like, because they're so fast.
On to
and
the
like,
next.
Mm-hmm. And it's just like, everyone's been on a plane. Like, you can put yourself in the situation and be like, holy crap. Like, it's just so good.
All right.
Yeah.
Hijack, I like this one.
Mm-hmm.
I can watch that. The last thing I watched that Blackbird on Apple TV and I liked it.
I promise you'll like Hijack.
It was the same kind of thing. I'm with these people making like the 6 and 7 episode deals.
Yeah, don't intimidate me.
I don't, every time anybody, I liked it, and I like this recommendation because... Anytime anybody, like even Marcus Smart, when I did that interview with him,
mm-hmm.
and what was the Viking? There's a Viking show that's on.
Is it Vikings?
Netflix. No, it's not called Vikings, but it's like a Viking show. It's like a what's the name of it? The Last King. I can't remember what it's called.
The Last Kingdom.
That's it. Mm-hmm. That's it. And he's like, I just finished it. Unbelievable. He absolutely loves it. Mm-hmm. And then when I ask, he's like, it was like the whatever, the fifth season?
Oh. Yeah.
It's a lot. It's something like that.
I'm not
like,
starting something that has five
seasons. I know. It's going to take me forever.
Give me a one season in and
right?
out.
Yeah, the six, seven episodes thing is, that has been so refreshing recently. There's been a bunch of those.
Oh, the Chat Likes right? Hijack, too.
Chat Likes Hijack as mm-hmm. well? All right, I'm going to watch it. Apple
yeah,
TV,
you'll
huh?
like it. It's
you may,
so
you
good.
May have just gotten Roser to subscribe to Apple TV.
Do
Who
it,
knows?
Rosie.
Probably not.
Probably
At
not.
At least get the free trial. Try one episode.
No.
I don't know. Hey.
I don't do the free trial.
Hey.
That's how they get you.
Hey.
Well, just cancel it. Speaking, what are you talking about?
Yeah, because you forget to cancel it.
So don't
it.
Forget.
No. That's how it happens.
Speaking of TV, I'm going to have a decision to make here pretty soon.
Uh-oh.
Because.
Oh, NFL.
Have you seen this about the I think there was an article in one of the local papers today, and it was like, because the headline was Memphians got to figure out what to do this weekend. So I have DirecTV.
Yeah.
You know, I've talked about this on the air for years. I only had it because of Sunday Ticket. So I was going to have to make that decision this year anyway. Like, what am I going to do about this? You know, YouTube TV ain't got the Grizzlies thing. DirecTV still doesn't have a deal with Bally, right? And so I was already stressed out about that. Bro, how about this? I don't have Channel 3.
What's 3?
College CBS. Football, NFL, and nope. college football.
It's also the end of the St. Jude tournament.
Yeah, it is.
This weekend.
I thought
and
you had everything.
There's like a quote saying they want double what they've been paying or whatever. God. And so they're like fighting over this. And they're like, hopefully we can have it back on by NFL season or whatever. And I'm like, this is just getting so annoying. Now, thank God. And I would say for anybody out there that has satellite like me or like any of these things that you can't get Channel 3 right now, because the tournament's going to be on this weekend, that is where that thing that I bought, that digital antenna that picks up 65 channels.
The bunny ears.
You can plug that thing into any TV now
yeah,
on the back with a coax.
That's so nice.
And no lie, when I plugged that little antenna in, it picked up 65 channels, including all the locals.
Yeah. Damn.
So, like, I don't need them to give me the locals.
Yeah.
But it does, it's mega annoying.
Yeah.
This TV thing is really coming to a head.
Mm-hmm.
Because I'm like, now, I should know this as one of the broadcasters. If you don't, like, could you have, when you had, like, YouTube TV, could you have just bought the Bally app? And gotten Grizzly games?
This is before they ever announced the Bally's app.
But I think you can.
Because it was still
Fox. I think
Fox.
You could just buy the app
it was not,
and then watch games on
yeah,
that, right?
It was not Bally's at the time. It was still Fox Sports when I had YouTube TV.
Okay.
It was still Fox Sports Southeast.
But theoretically, no matter what you had, you could just buy yeah. the app because the app is on anything,
yeah.
right?
The TV. You're right about the TV thing. I mean, you've seen all the stuff. Like Disney's trying to pawn ESPN off on like multiple people.
Yeah, I don't know what to do about
and
this.
Then, but they also said, dude, we talked about this a couple of years. ESPN is going to go direct to consumer. They are going to be
As
off.
They should.
It is going to be off of cable, and they literally read the stories. The only reason it is taking longer is because they know it will destroy cable television completely. Because they're, dude, that is the only reason I have cable TV.
It's the only reason
is
a lot
for
of
live
have.
Sports. It's the only reason I have it.
Hey, Hulu has live sports.
I do not watch enough TNT, TBS, USA. Like I
the TNT games. I would miss
TNT
Thursdays.
Games. TNT games are cool. Like, there's.
I really can't think of any other channels I watch.
But there's so much stuff on there. Like, I do not.
But
like,
I gotta.
Like, so NBC.
I gotta figure out the Grizzlies thing.
Yeah. So NBC, dude. I've got Peacock. I don't need NBC the channel. I've got Peacock. Anything that's on NBC, I can watch on Peacock.
How about stream. And that's what's crazy. On like you go to like Paramount. Or you go to CBS Sports or whatever.
All the NFL, all the college football.
No. I'm saying, like, even on those, though, no. If I click on them now, no.
Oh.
Your carrier does not. I could never. So it was, what was it? What was whatever it was last weekend, the Wyndham Championship.
Oh, yeah.
I was trying to watch the end of the Wyndham Championship, and I couldn't get it on anything.
Yeah.
Because it was saying Nextstar and DirecTV are in a fight, blah, blah, blah. And I'm like, okay.
Ridiculous.
I don't care.
Ridiculous.
Like, oh, dude. It's every, like, you, I mean, look, you went through it with the, with the whole YouTube. As soon as you got YouTube, they lost the regional sports or whatever, like the packages. And so you couldn't watch the Grizzlies. You then switched off of it. But, yeah, I got to figure that thing out. Right now, out at the golf tournament, Adam Svensson is 4-under. And he's got the lead. And there's a ton of guys at 3-under. Biggest name in that group is Jordan Spieth. He's at 3-under. And so my boy Thigala's in the top 10 already. Let's go. Let's go. He's -2. All right, take a quick break. We'll play a little fill in the blank on the other side. Chris Furnace Show.
No matter what time of year it is, there's always something exciting happening at FedEx Forum in Memphis. And when you want tickets to the hottest concerts, sporting events, and more, you can find them at Ticketmaster. As the official marketplace of the Memphis Grizzlies and FedEx Forum, Ticketmaster has a wide selection of tickets available for all the events you can't miss. Check out what's happening at FedEx Forum and get tickets today at Ticketmaster.com.
LifeCare Ambulance is proud to be an official partner of the Memphis Grizzlies and FedEx Forum. At LifeCare, they wear their hearts with pride. Their passion is their people. They want you to love what you do and where you do it. Their employee-driven culture encourages a healthy work-life balance and supportive work environment. They invest in your success and well-being so that you can provide the best care for the patients that they serve. Join the incredible team of EMTs and paramedics in Memphis, Nashville, and across the nation today. Learn more at lifecareamb.com.
FIBA basketball, international basketball, the topic of this last segment, and the Memphis Grizzlies have two players that will be participating. Jaren Jackson Jr. will be playing for Team USA, and Santi Aldama will play for Spain.
Hey, Grizzlies fans, be sure to tune in to Grizzbeat, where the panel and I break down all things Grizzlies and take a look at the rest of the NBA as well. The show is live every Wednesday, 2 p.m. on YouTube at Grind City Media and the official Grind City Media app.
Topic number one, I think, was not so creative.
Okay.
And it is the new color of this eggplant retro foam.
Okay.
I was going to bring this, the actual original in, and I forgot.
Well, we have a picture of the original, too. If we could go to that second. Okay. Okay. The Sneak Fest Show, live Tuesdays at 2 p.m. on YouTube at Grind City Media and the official Grind City Media app.
There is a good chance that a short king will start Saturday alone atop the Open Championship leaderboard. Brian Harman, he is 36 years old. And most importantly, again, he's 5'7", which is good news for those of us who don't want to watch tall people take control of yet another sport. They can have the NFL. They can have the NBA. But golf should be a short king safe space.
The Gary Parrish Show, live weekdays at 10 a.m. on YouTube at Grind City Media and the official Grind City Media app.
We got a special guest, Kelvin Gates.
I treat HBCU Huddle like my ESPN HBCU Huddle. You know, and I'm getting mad. I'm throwing stuff. I'm driving fast because Mike said something bad about Jackson State. He predicted, CJ might have predicted that we might lose a game.
Get all of your HBCU sports and culture news by tuning in to HBCU Huddle with CJ Hurt and Mike Wallace. New episodes drop every Thursday on GrindCityMedia.com, YouTube, and Spotify.
The Braves have been the hottest team in baseball. Their June was just phenomenal. And you look at the numbers, the Braves are the betting favorite to win the World Series.
The Braves are like clearly been one of the best teams in the league, if not the best team in baseball all season. And like, I don't know how to pick against them. And they're going to get better.
The Odds Couple with Rob Fisher, Lang Whitaker, John Roser, and CJ Hurt live Thursdays at 2 p.m. on YouTube at Grind City Media and the official Grind City Media app.
Rob, we got a banger that you guys need to play. So I'm going to send this to you right here, and you just play it for the people. We are SEC.
It just means more.
We got all the Southeast with me.
Oh, yes, we do.
Tune in to the Jessica Benson Show with CJ Hurt live every weekday at 8 a.m. on YouTube at Grind City Media and the official Grind City Media app.
Don't put off getting your oil changed, Memphis, the Grizzlies' official partner. Take 5 oil changes faster than you think. There's no appointment needed. There isn't even a waiting room. Yep, you heard that correctly. Take 5 oil changes so fast you don't even have to get out of your car. You can take advantage of Take 5's fast, friendly, and simple service at any of their locations across the Memphis area. And remember, at Take 5, you stay in your car because they're faster than you think. That means you won't even have time to show off your perfect jump shot or your killer crossover. Take 5, the stay in your car 10-minute oil change.
Memphis fans can now enhance each moment of their day with the refreshingly luxurious taste of Cintron Sparkling Flavored Energy Beverages, served exclusively at FedEx Forum. Cintron World is a lifestyle beverage brand inspiring everyone to create their lives with intention, energy, and style. As the official partner of the Grizzlies, Cintron is offering a 10% discount on your next online order when you use promo code Grizzlies10 at CintronWorld.com and follow the lifestyle on social at Cintron World. Drink it, live it.
Welcome back to the Chris Vernon Show on YouTube at Grind City Media and the official Grind City Media app, presented by Caesars Sportsbook. Now, back to your host, Chris Vernon.
All right, we're back. Chris Vernon Show. Get that Caesars Sportsbook app. You can go to your app store. You can type in Caesars Sportsbook, and you can download it. Today, it is free to download. It is legal to use in the state of Tennessee. And you can get up to $1,250 back as a free bet if you don't win using the code VernonFull. VernonFull. Starting next week, we'll get Brian Edwards on. We'll talk to him about the upcoming college football season. Man, I sprayed the board on this golf tournament.
Oh, God.
I have Morikawa. I have Homa. I have Finau, I have Thigala, and I have Tom Kim.
To win? All to win?
6 of them. Morikawa, Homa, Finau, Kim, Thigala, Burns.
Can anyone hear Finau without seeing his jingle?
So no. I just got a video sent to me. Our boss, Pugs, has a house behind one. And they held up a huge boombox playing Where He Be Now,
See?
Tony Finau, as Tony walked by and he waved to the
That's so cute.
To the house. They did.
That's funny.
They sent me the video. They're
That's
all out
funny.
There.
I can't
They're all
hear
out
his
there
name
watching
him
walk by. He and he's playing well so far. He's in the mix. He's 2 under, I think, through 5 holes. So yeah. Tony Finau with off to a little bit of a good start. All right, we're going to do a couple fill in the blanks before we get out of here.
It's time for fill in the blank. Answers you can take to the bank. It's time for fill in the blank. Answers you can take to the bank.
It's fill in the blank.
All right. All right. I love mine last week. I don't this week, so I'm just going to do one of them. Okay. We were talking about the other night at my house. We were talking about going on our last vacation, and we were talking about how we didn't get to go to Universal Studios, and one of the big things there is Harry Potter, right? And then we got into Harry a discussion Potter. About how none of us have ever watched Harry Potter. Like, none of us read any of the books. None of us watched any of the movies. Neither of my kids have read the books or watched any of the movies.
Probably why I like your kids.
But we're probably, like, the only people. Like, what is the biggest phenomenon or thing that you have absolutely no awareness of, never watched, never read? That thing is...
Fill in the blank, sucker!
Harry Potter.
Oh.
It is?
100%. I refuse
Damn,
to.
I
will
Harry
never.
Potter.
I will never read a Harry Potter book. I will never watch a Harry Potter movie. Scarred me. Used to get told I look like Harry Potter.
Can I ask you a quick question?
I used to have hair down to here, the glasses. I used to get told I look like Harry Potter. And I said, I look like this before Harry Potter did. He can kiss my ass. He looks like me. I don't look like him. I refuse to watch Harry Potter. Daniel Radcliffe can go to hell.
Did you expect such an angry answer to your fill in the blank?
He did look like Harry Potter.
I did. I absolutely look like Harry Potter.
Do you have a scar on your forehead?
I didn't know Harry Potter had a scar.
A lightning bolt
scar. I do have one. I got like a bump right there.
No, it's a lightning bolt scar.
I had a buddy chase me with an electric drill when I was in like 7 years old, and I ran into a metal pole.
That's not your buddy.
Busted my head open.
You watched the Harry Potters?
Yes, and read all the books.
Would you recommend?
Nerd.
Yes.
All of them?
Yes.
No.
Is it worth it? Well, how many are there?
Seven?
There's seven movies?
Six?
There's six movies?
How many Harry Potter books?
Dang.
Are there?
Books?
I read all the books. Yeah, there's seven books.
Hell no.
And they're long as hell,
yeah,
too.
Yeah, they're thick. I felt so cool when I finished one when I was, like, little.
Yeah.
I know.
Just was that, dude. It came out, like, I think I was in college.
I can't even finish a coloring book.
I was a nerd growing up, though. I loved reading.
All right, so Roser's on the Harry. I mean, look, there's a million of these with me. I haven't watched anything.
Yeah, there's, I'm sure there's others.
Lord of the Rings, Star Wars.
Oh, yeah, I've never seen any of the Lord of the Rings.
Star Wars, Star Trek.
All right, I've seen the Lord of the Rings.
I haven't seen Lord of the Rings.
I remember I watched that cartoon Hobbit a lot when I was a kid.
So I haven't seen the movie The Hobbit, but I've seen the Lord of the Rings, The Two Towers, and The Return of the King. I've seen those three.
Know.
They're freaking awesome. They are. They're awesome. They're really good.
Of course
good.
They are.
But I'm not reading any of the books.
You never seen Star Wars.
Nope. Like, I know who like Luke Skywalker is, but I've never seen it.
Kelsey, I'm making some people. It's fine. Star Wars is fine, but
that's
not.
That's probably the biggest one.
Star Wars?
Though. Yeah.
It's like, massive.
Especially because.
And it's probably because I was scarred too, because everyone called me Chewbacca in middle school because I had leg hair. Like, okay.
You got Chewbacca and Yeti?
Wait.
Well, it was all the same thing.
Yeti and Chewbacca.
They called you Chewbacca because you had leg hair?
Yeah, I went through puberty really early.
Did they walk by you and be like,
rah! Oh, my brother does that noise like better than that. Like, to this day.
Yeah. You didn't, thanks, you didn't guys. Shave your legs?
I was like in fourth grade.
So?
I was a little kid.
You got to learn how to shave.
Well, I did eventually.
You got body hair that early, you got to shave
I'm
it.
I'm good
now. Is it like your eyebrows? Is it like that dark hair? I'm like, guys.
Yeah, did you really look like Chewbacca?
You guys.
It wasn't like light color. Was it like black hair?
Yes, I have dark hair.
Did you walk into school like, hi?
Hold on.
Guys.
You had black hairy legs?
I wore long socks to cover it. It was an embarrassing time. I was a little kid.
So it looked like you had knee pads?
Oh, my God.
You look like Bill Walton played for the Trailblazers.
They didn't know they had Teen Wolf at their school.
I wasn't a teen. I was in fourth grade.
Like basketball. They had a Teen Wolf.
Well, once somebody called you a woolly mammoth or whatever they called you,
I had to,
didn't you say to your
didn't
mom,
you just go
like,
and get,
hey,
like, scissors and start cutting the hair?
Mom, what do we do about
so
this?
So I actually had to write my mom an essay to start shaving my legs.
What do you mean you had to write her an essay?
Yeah, I had to write her. My brother had to like write her
about
an essay.
What?
To, like,
about what? About your hairy legs?
Yeah, about how I wanted to shave. Yeah.
Wait, she didn't encourage this?
Were you raised in the woods? I was young.
What?
I'm not raised in the woods.
Woman of the woods.
I was a baby.
Yeah, but you once you said, hey, boys are making fun of me because of...
Yeah, I think she thought that like I could
do
just
hairy
say
pits
like
too?
Yeah, babies don't have pit hair.
I don't really have armpit hair now, so I probably didn't have it back then. No, just legs and arms and my mustache. I'm done.
And your mustache. Jesus, you look like Luigi.
This is getting...
It's a me, a Kelsey.
It's a me.
So Harry Potter's the answer for
it. It's a me. What's going on with you? Fourth grader walking around with hairy legs and a mustache. Jesus.
Tough,
all right.
Tough time.
Glow up, queen. Glow up, queen, for real. Let's see these hairy leg mustaches.
You also.
I'll bring
you,
some pictures.
It's
in
a me.
100% you had hairy pits.
Oh,
if
yeah.
you had
no,
a mustache,
really
your hairy, you
I don't have hairy pits now. So, like, I can't imagine me having them back then.
Well, you don't, because you shave them.
No, like, I don't.
Yeah.
It doesn't really grow there.
Enough.
Okay.
What do you got?
Okay, I have three. Do you want me to do three? Or
yeah, go for it.
Okay.
They're going to be better than mine, so.
Okay. Well, number one, this is a very obvious one.
Because Reiser's going to be like, today is National Peanut Day. What's your favorite nut?
I'll tell you what my favorite nut is.
Pause.
John Morant's birthday is today.
Yeah.
He's been with us for 4 years, going on his fifth. Your favorite Ja memory so far is?
Fill in the blank, sucker.
I think there's three.
Oh my gosh.
That I went the craziest over. The Baines dunk.
The Kevin Love dunk.
No.
Oh my.
No,
nope,
not the Kevin Love.
I
the
wasn't Baines watching dunk, when that one happened.
The Baines dunk, the Beasley dunk.
Yeah.
Mm. And the Minnesota game winner.
Okay.
Where Anthony Edwards tries to jump mm-hmm. the pass.
Yeah.
I mean, that was a game winner in the playoffs. Mm-hmm. That way, the call 12 thing, mm-hmm. like that was probably like those two dunks and that game winner are the ones that stand out the most.
The Spurs.
The splitter.
The not splitter. The other who? But they're well, the big white guy for the Spurs. They're all Tiago Splitter. Jakob Poeltl, Tiago Splitter. It's literally the same thing.
Yeah.
And then the Adams pass to him at the end of the half because it was
that was cool.
Back to I mean it happened like that was. That one, and then, I mean, Tillman hit probably the biggest shot, but that play-in game on the road at Golden State, Ja was freaking so awesome in that game.
Yeah.
Scored like 30-something. I mean, it was
yeah, pretty awesome.
There's a lot of good Ja memories.
Yeah, those three stand out to me the most.
Yeah.
Those two dunks, because Baines, he had not dunked on anyone
year,
and it like basically won the game.
They did. It won the game.
And I jumped off my couch like, I mean, that was just, it was so shocking.
I also remember
you had the poster printed the next morning.
I did. I had it printed the next morning.
I do remember his first career game winner. It was on the road in Charlotte when he drove the lane and did like that up and under on the road in Charlotte. And he had a ton of fans there too because he had a bunch of family there because South Carolina.
His dad was sprinting down the sideline. Yeah.
The Brooklyn game here where he blocked Kyrie and then made the pass to Jay.
Yep. The pass to Crowder to win the game.
A lot of unbelievable plays, mm-hmm. man.
Got a bunch of them. That was the
Kevin
first.
Love one still sticks out. I know it's a miss, but like that still sticks out in my mind.
I,
maybe
so
because the picture is
I
so
wasn't. I was in my car when that happened. I was not watching it live because it was in Cleveland and it was one of those
early
6 o'clock games. No, I was at William was playing basketball at like Second Presbyterian, and I was at his game. I had gone to his game.
Crazy. Okay. Steph Curry, if you saw this, performed live at the Chase Center with Paramore.
I did.
I saw this.
Which is pretty cool. The Grizzlies player and artist you think would be the funniest / like random collab at a concert at FedEx Forum is?
Fill in the blank, sucker.
Brandon Clark with Macklemore.
No, that would fit.
Yeah, it would fit.
Like, Steph with Paramore was, like, so strange.
That was.
John Morant and Stevie Nicks. Oh. Stevie Nicks is coming here. If he got up there and sang a Fleetwood Mac song.
We would all be like.
If he, like, sang Landslide.
That would be.
I would lose my mind.
Yeah.
Like, it would have to be somebody like anything. I think Morant and any, like.
Non-rapper.
Easy listening or, like, yeah.
If John Morant shows up at Chris Stapleton and sings Tennessee Whiskey,
yes.
Like
that would be so cool.
Yeah.
Yes. Like somebody, something like that.
Yeah.
Or like last night, I think it was last night, they do that. It was last night. They do the FedEx fundraiser here at the Forum
mm-hmm.
For St. Jude. And you know who performed there? Rascal Flatt. So like any of our players singing Rascal
any
Flatt.
Of them?
Well, except for like Conchar, he'd probably
God
love it.
Bless
but like
broken room.
Yeah, like somebody.
Oh, the chat had a good one.
Who?
Jiddy and Glorilla.
Oh, amazing. Yes. Or yeah, Jiddy and Canard.
No,
any of the white guys with like the money bag.
Jiddy and October 24th, Kirk Franklin. Jiddy and Kirk Franklin. Or Stephen Adams and Kirk Franklin.
I was
going to
say Stephen Adams and Kirk Franklin would be good.
Yep. All right. What was your last one?
Put your hands together.
Okay. Do you guys remember when the news came out about Reggie Bullock owning a private island in Belize?
No.
Yeah. So it came out at the end of the season.
Reggie Bullock owns an island?
Reggie Bullock?
Yeah.
That played for the Mavs?
I thought you said Reggie Bush.
No.
Reggie Bullock.
Wow.
He's got that kind of money?
So he bought a private island in Belize.
All right.
And so he was building it all up, and now the first kind of like video came out about like his little private island and what it looks like and stuff. So let's just say every NBA player decides to buy an island.
Okay.
The NBA player whose island you'd most like to holiday on is?
Fill in the blank, sucker.
The island I would most want to holiday on.
Assuming they're there with you.
So I'm gonna imagine that it would be somebody like.
I need something laid back. Like, I don't need somebody like raging all the time, you know. So Jaws out.
I want somebody like that would be like fun.
Roser doesn't. Roser wants the opposite.
Yeah, no, I want the opposite of fun.
No. But like, they'd be like, you know. I think Giannis would be cool.
Giannis Antetokounmpo.
Yeah, I bet Giannis would. Because he's just a cheery guy. He feels like positive. He's smiling all
the
time.
He's not going to party either. But it's going
to
be fun.
And he's funny. I just think he would probably be like delightful to be around. I'm trying to think of like somebody that I want to be around.
Delightful, such a cute word.
Yeah, I think he's like, he strikes me as that kind of dude. Like, I mean, he's like, he kind of walks in and lights up rooms. People like him.
Mm-hmm.
Right? And I don't know how many of these guys that I think would like wake up and they're perpetually like funny and in a good mood. And
Boban.
Oh, stop.
Boban.
Boban's island.
Yeah.
No, come on.
Yeah,
come on.
Hanging with Boban.
Zion's that have the best food.
Well, of
course. All right.
Yikes.
Damn. Harden's would be too lit.
Yeah, Harden's not a chance.
Someone said Jimmy Butler in the chat. I think that would be a fun island.
Jimmy Butler would probably be fun.
Yeah, he's Jimmy fun. Butler could be fun.
Yeah. I feel like Giannis is like one of the very few that would like actually host you. Like, make sure you're doing.
Do you think Steven Adams would?
No. I don't think he would care if you're having a good time.
No, okay. He'd just be, yeah. Kyrie.
He would not care if you're having a good time.
Kyrie, because Kyrie would set up like a whole like vibe for his, and he would want to make sure you're getting the true experience.
I'm trying to think of who else I think would be like, you know, a good host.
Make sure that you're like the
Donovan Mitchell, I think, would be a good host.
He'd have lots of like, see him, he'd have like spades games and
yeah,
like,
and I just think he's like probably a good host.
What about Drew Holiday?
Not smile enough for me.
Yeah, not smiley, of course.
Right. Jaren would be fun.
Oh, for sure. He'd be our best.
Jaren's island?
Yes. I think he would be, like, fun. You know what I mean? And he'd make sure that you were happy and make sure everybody's having a good time. And Anthony Edwards as well.
Yeah.
No, that's fun. Fun.
I think too lit.
He's funny as well.
I think too lit.
He'd be fun, though.
Anthony Edwards.
He'd be fun.
Be a lot of racket going on when I'm trying to sleep.
Oh my God.
All right. Do you have anything good or no?
What do I got? Oh, the Naismith, the Hall of Fame enshrinement is this weekend.
Oh.
At least I gather it is. I'm seeing a bunch of stories about it. So it's Dirk, Dwayne Wade, Pau Gasol, Tony Parker all going in. The Hall of Fame that you would most want to visit is.
Fill in the blank, sucker.
I think baseball.
Baseball?
Yeah, because it's the oldest and because it's the one that everybody says is the most amazing. That whole town, evidently, Cooperstown, is all base. Like, there's, like, baseball card stores and memorabilia stores or whatever up and down the street in the town. And, like, that one is, like, the spectacular one.
Yeah.
Most people say the basketball one ain't that good and the football one ain't that good.
I've been to the football one.
So they say the baseball one's amazing. Everybody I know that's been to Cooperstown says it's incredible. So I think just because it's that... You know, yeah, I think Cooperstown.
I've been to the Hockey Hall of Fame.
Me and Rose have been to the NASCAR Hall of Fame.
Is it cool?
Freaking awesome.
It is. It is fun.
I don't know if I care. I don't want to like.
We didn't care either.
Yeah, no.
No, I'm saying about many Hall of Fames. Like, I'm not the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame in Cleveland.
Yeah, I'd like to go to that. Yeah, I want to go to that.
I've been outside of it. I guess I've been inside
Rock and Roll Hall of Fame. That's probably mine.
The Bowling Hall of Fame's in St. Louis.
Not the bowling.
Yeah, it is.
That's pretty cool. I like bowling. I'm down with bowling.
I don't know if I care enough to go to any Hall of Fames. I guess, like, the NBA one, what I would have the most interest in, but, like...
But it's basketball. That's the problem. It's the basketball
Hall of
Fame. Yeah,
it's not the NBA Hall of Fame.
So it's...
But I bet it's cool.
Fine.
I bet it's cool.
Players and
the Naismith Memorial.
Have you ever heard anybody say, oh my God, I love
Ben?
But I have had buddies that have gone to Cooperstown that have said it's insane. Just incredible.
Yeah.
And there's so much history, and it's like.
I'm looking up some good Hall of Fames. Hold on.
Baseball's a lot of history.
Space Hall of Fame?
Space?
Yeah, like space travel.
We're talking about that space.
Oh, the Hollywood Walk of Fame.
That was all fake.
Yeah, but the Hollywood Walk of Fame is huge.
It's just stars on a. The Country Music Hall of Fame is in Nashville.
You don't care enough.
Roser wants to go to the National Cowgirl Museum and Hall of Fame in Fort Worth, Texas.
That sounds good. I don't know what that is.
Gunfighter Hall of Fame in Arizona. Oh my God, the Mascot Hall of Fame?
Yeah, that sounds kind of cool.
Oh, there is one in Milwaukee. The Bobblehead Hall of Fame.
I would
love to go to that. I would love to go to the Bobblehead Hall of Fame.
That's right up your alley.
Yeah. Where is the Hockey Hall of Fame?
Toronto.
It's in Toronto? Yeah, have you been to that?
Yeah, it's right downtown.
Is it awesome?
No.
I bet it's good. No?
No.
Not good.
It's quite small.
Huh.
How?
World Chess Hall of Fame?
Nah.
No, chess is weird.
Boxing Hall of Fame?
That'd be cool.
It's in New York.
A lot of history with
boxing.
It's
in New York?
Mm-hmm.
I didn't even know.
It's in Canastota, New York.
Yeah, Canastota.
Racing, Bass Fishing Hall of Fame in Missouri.
Let's go.
Cost you $29.95 to get in.
Bill Dance, shout out Bill Dance.
Oh, yeah. The coolest. Oh, this is. I'm in a rabbit hole now. The coolest Hall of Fame in every state.
Just give us one.
Yeah, what's Tennessee?
Okay.
Do we have a Hall of Fame here?
Memphis Music Hall of Fame.
In Nashville, you probably do.
Oh, yeah.
Tennessee is...
The Country Music Hall.
The
country. It's going to be the Country Music Hall of Fame.
Yeah.
Sorry, I'm still scrolling.
In Nashville.
It is the Country Music Hall of Fame.
In Nashville?
Yeah, I guess.
It's in Nashville.
That's crap. Do you see the renderings of the new stadium?
Utah, Museums of Olympic Park.
Nah.
Vermont is a ski one.
Renderings of... Yes.
The
stadium...
The video that just came out of it, I mean, dude, they're getting the Super Bowl, they're getting WrestleMania, they're getting the Final Four, like it's, yeah.
The Pinball Hall of Fame in Las Vegas?
They still ain't got no culture.
Still ain't got no culture. Yeah. Have fun having Dierks Bentley sing your national anthem.
Try that in a small town.
Oh, my.
Yeah, try that in a small town.
All right, that's going to do it for today.
Also, we wish happy birthday to Ja, but also a happy birthday to Kylie Jenner.
Why?
Billionaire at 26. She was going to be the subject of my other fill in the blank. But.
Happy birthday, Ja.
Yeah, happy birthday, Ja.
Happy birthday, Ja.
All right. Thanks to John Roser. Thanks to Kelsey Wright Johnson. Thank you to Kimball back in the studio. No show tomorrow. Go out to the golf tournament. Enjoy with your family and your friends. And we'll be back on Monday. Until then, we gone.